Hi guys, Dr. J here, and in this video we're going to talk about, in more detail, surface and volume scattering models for radar and just general radar backscattering issues. So we've talked about this already in somewhat in brief, basically, and we've got the two kind of models here: a smooth surface, rough surface, and of course rough surfaces are radar bright because they reflect light in all different directions. Of course, you can have different levels of roughness, calling this a faceted rough surface, but basically rough at different wavelengths. And of course, you can imagine if you have a surface which is smooth at certain wavelengths, so let's say a surface which is roughly flat at a meter length scale and larger, then depending on your radar wavelength, it's going to see that as a smooth surface or rough surface. And we can sort of conceptualize radar backscattering as collections of these different types of scatterers. And so we can think about roughness of different points and how those all add together. We've already discussed this, but as I've said before, within a particular pixel, there might be more than one type of surface. So radar pixels, depending on the wavelength, is going to be from a meter or so. Sometimes a half a meter for the very highest resolution sensors, like X-band sensors. But for most sensors, Sentinel 1, NiSAR, you're talking a few meters up to as many as, say, 20 or 30 meters at the full resolution. That's the resolution at full resolution. And of course, we'll talk about later about processing techniques where you can sort of multi-look, combine pixels together to try to do better in certain types of noise. But full resolution is anywhere from probably a few meters to up to 20 or 30 meters. Radar images are distorted relative to a planimetric view, so obviously you're looking in one direction. You've got an issue if you have topography where certain areas are going to be lit more directly, certain areas are not. Steep slopes are collapsed into a single range cell called that's called layover, and other areas might be occulted or shadowed. Radar is primarily sensitive to the structure of objects being imaged, whereas optical images are primarily sensitive to chemistry. This says chemistry, but basically that's the light, the particular color wavelengths that get reflected from images, which is in fact a function of chemistry. So radar is going to be sensitive to the structure of objects as opposed to their color or chemistry or makeup. And then, of course, as I said, the scale of objects relative to the radar wavelength determines how smooth an object appears, and also how bright or dark the image is. So if you have a smooth surface at some wavelength, that's going to be a dark reflection. But if you change the wavelength, if you're looking at a road, for example, the road might be smooth at a meter long wavelength, but at a millimeter wavelength, the road might look fairly rough. So this idea of wavelength interacting with the surface, or a measure of the surface scale, this is a very important concept in radar. We've talked about it some already. So if we take L band, C band, and X band, these are some of the most common radar bands, 24 centimeters, that's going to be penetrating through most of a tree canopy, for example. It's going to be interacting with probably the trunks of the trees. It's going to get reflections from the trunks of the trees, branches which are 24 centimeters and larger, and then of course the ground surface. Whereas C band is going to be interacting at 6, 5.5 or so centimeters, it's going to be interacting with lots of branches, some of the leaves, larger leaves. And X band is really just going to be, it's not even going to be penetrating the canopy at all. It's going to be interacting with the leaves at the very tops of the trees, even for small leaves. So how objects look is going to depend on the radar wavelength. Same thing with soil. So radar waves will penetrate soil. Some of you may be familiar with ground penetrating radar, which of course is radar which is penetrating the ground. That of course is a different wavelength. So you're talking gigahertz instead of megahertz frequencies. So a surface might look rough to X-band data. Say the same thing with the pavement. To X-band data at 3 centimeters, you might have a very rough surface, just the ground surface itself. Whereas if you have a dirt area or a concrete or asphalt area, that might look very smooth to an L-band radar. And then for ice is a big deal for InSAR. You can look at ice and measure ice speed and things like that. You might see surface and layering that are rough to X band but not to L band. So again, just depending on the scale of the object and what your wavelengths are, your radar waves are going to interact most strongly with objects of that size, and it's interacting with the structure. One other thing we should talk about, this is not going to be too big of a deal for NSAR, but it is a big deal for SAR, and some of you may end up using SAR in the future, is polarization. So you can have waves that are polarized, and so this is basically, you know, just ordinary light is going to have waves oscillating in all sorts of different directions, but you can use a polarization filter to get just vertically polarized, just horizontally polarized, or really any angle, any single polarization angle you can produce using these filters. Vertical polarization passes through the horizontally arranged observers, and horizontal polarization does not pass through the horizontally arranged observers. So if you have, anyway, different radars are going to use different polarizations. So for example, NISAR is gonna have quad pole for some areas and dual pole for other areas. That means horizontal and vertically polarized. Different polarizations are sensitive to different things, and this is especially useful for agriculture and plants, forestry. It turns out the different polarizations are sensitive to different aspects of plants and plant material, and so that's very useful for seeing things like plant health, crop types, distinguishing between different types of crops in a field, things like this. Again, not used so much for NSAR itself, but a very useful technique that can be used looking at soil moisture, looking at plant type, things like that. And again, the whole idea here is that the radar wave is interacting with the structure in different ways based on these different polarizations. All right, so we've talked about backscatter and how a pixel is a sum of backscatters that are inside that pixel. So this is kind of illustrating that. Full resolution SAR imagery has a grainy appearance, and this is called speckle, which is a phenomenon due to the coherent nature of SAR imaging. The total signal returned from a resolution cell is the coherent sum of the returns from all the individual scatters within it that are generally randomly distributed. So what that means is that if you have a particular pixel, there's a bunch of scatters inside that pixel, maybe a car, maybe a plant, maybe a house, depending, of course, on the size of your pixel. And each one of those scatterers is going to return a radar wave from the incident wave, and those are all going to add together. And so you'll see the total sum of your return is going to be a combination of all of the individual elements. And the problem we have is that, maybe not the problem, but the issue that we run into is that the return signal is going to be the phase of the signal is going to be generally random. The phases of the different scatterers really don't have any correlation with each other, and so we tend to see a random phase from pixel to pixel. So, as I say here, return signal is a coherent combination of the returns from the scattering elements, all the scattering contributions, and then the range phase, and that's going to be your total signal, return signal. Now, what does this mean? So here is a speckle. You can see how on this surface you have kind of light and dark alternating colors. This is backscatter, which contains surface information independent of signal-to-noise ratio. Spatial averaging reduces the speckle and draws out the natural backscatter reflectivity. So essentially, by averaging in a particular pixel, or a group of pixels, I should say, averaging these pixels here would sort of give you the average backscatter of that area, and is oftentimes what we want to see. We want to see sort of the average or the smoothed out backscatter. Some cases you really want to see that high resolution signal. In many cases you are better off with averaging. Now here's where we get into interferometry. I'll just briefly touch on this here and we'll talk more about it later. You have two SAR acquisitions, so you've imaged the same point on the ground using this synthetic aperture radar. You acquire one image, you acquire the second image. Each image has an amplitude and a phase because it's a complex image. So here's our phase on the left-hand side. You see that it's essentially random, white noise kind of signal. The second signal, there's the phase as well. Now notice the amplitude looks much more like an actual image of the surface. So the amplitude of our SAR signal is actually very strongly correlated with the surface structures. And we can see a lot of detail in those structures. And again, keeping in mind that this is not an optical image of the structures, but it's a radar image of the structures. So let's look at an example here of SAR imaging. And this particular image is just the amplitude. It's the amplitude of the backscattered echoes. So one thing I should mention, which I don't know that I have yet, is that radar sees through clouds. So all weather imaging is possible. You don't need illumination by the sun. It's an active sensor, so it's sending out those radar waves. Doesn't matter if it's sunny or not. And of course, this is the great advantage of radar over optical satellites, is that they're all weather, day or night time imaging. Of course, optical has other advantages over radar, such as it's what we see. It's an actual representation of the surface, but radar has this benefit of being all weather imaging. The surface roughness and slopes control the strength of the backscatter. We've talked about that. So let's take a look here. This is Kilauea caldera in Hawaii on the Big Island of Hawaii. Here we have a flight direction going from bottom to top of the image. And so our look direction is to the right. And so here the radar illumination is from the left. You can see these bright areas here where the radar is hitting the far side of the crater, or the caldera, I should say, caldera walls. And those are very bright. And then over here, where we can't quite image inside those caldera walls, you see these dark areas. So slopes facing towards the satellite have really bright backscatter, and slopes facing away from the satellite show dark backscatter or shadowing. Areas of vegetation are rough and have bright backscatter, whereas you have other areas which are relatively smooth and have less backscatter. So almost the opposite of what you would normally think. Smoother areas are darker, because even though they reflect better, they're reflecting the image off in another direction, whereas a very rough image, which reflects in all directions equally well, is again bright. So this is our SAR amplitude image. And here's our SAR satellites. Let's just quickly look at some of the SAR satellites. Here's an artist illustration of Sentinel-1A. And this is launched by the European Space Agency. A couple of satellites launched in 2014, 2016. Sentinel-1B, I believe, actually reached its end of life. It stopped working. So just Sentinel-1A is working now. So we have 12-day repeat times in the same orbit. You're ascending plus descending. So the satellite, as it's going north to south, it'll take an image, and then it'll also take an image south to north. So you can actually get images looking in both directions, both right and left, relative to north. Here's an ALOS-2 satellite, which was by the Japanese Space Agency. This has a 14-day repeat time. Depends on where you are. So some areas will have 14 days. Most areas, I would say, outside of the Japan area, have a 28-day repeat time. Can be even more than that, depending. Sometimes they'll turn the satellite in different directions. If there's a natural disaster or they need to get some data in a particular area, they'll turn the satellite away from where it would normally point. And so that can actually take away from the normal data acquisition. This is an L-band sensor, so it has longer wavelength. You have less decorrelation, less issues with penetrating vegetation, but doesn't orbit as often as the Sentinel satellites do. Sentinel satellites are C-band data, so 5 centimeters. So you do have more decorrelation. You have more sensitivity to smaller changes, but you also are able to see that detail. Okay, so we've talked about backscattering. We've talked about amplitude. In the next section here, where we're talking about interferometric SAR, we'll talk about how you can use the phase. And we separated out the amplitude from the phase. And then we take the phase from two different acquisitions, and that produces our INSAR. So we'll talk about that next time.